Thank you very much. And so now we are moving on the western part of the Balkans, Les Montanas, let's say. So in recent years, the Mediterranean dimension of the Cetina phenomenon has gained renewed attention. It is now recognized to be a complex phenomenon of long-range intertwined interactions, encompassing several Mediterranean regions, from the Western Balkans to the Peloponnese, Peninsular Italy, Eastern Sicily, Malta, and the Aeolian Island during the second half of the third millennium BC. Archaeological evidence, though, mainly consists of the distribution of Cetina-type pottery across these areas. This new attention perhaps has raised more awareness about Cetina features, and indeed, there has been a burst of Cetina discoveries in the Mediterranean regions encompassed by this phenomenon. In particular, we have new discoveries in England, southern Italy, the Peloponnese, and even in Albania, as Tobia and Maya will show us later. At present, it is widely accepted that the core area of Cetina is central northern Dalmatia, particularly the Dalmatinska Zagora. That is, this is the area in which has yielded the richest evidence of Cetina sites. So it is assumed that a culture whose distinct ceramic production for the Cetina pottery flourished there from the 3rd millennium BC till the early 2nd millennium BC. Yet, as we will see, the spread of Cetina features outside Dalmatia took multiple paths and different forms. It is highly likely that not all the regions yielding Cetina feature were actually directly reached by Cetina groups via movement or via exchange. So the ceramic model possibly spread through multiple contexts. But data on the Cetina culture is in its core area, Dalmatia, remains scanty. It is mainly known for its burial context, Cetina, consisting in inhumation and or incineration under stone tumuli. At present, open-air settlements are virtually unknown. More data come from caves, but these are mainly old excavations and not always published, as Professor Govedaris has reminded us. So we lack any data about the settlement patterns, economic strategies, and social organization. We know that Cetina culture probably spanned from the 3rd millennium BC to the early century of the 2nd millennium BC, but a chronological breakdown has yet to be refined. And I think that Maya is going to speak about this chronological breakdown possibly. So pottery still remain the main evidence for Cetina, but pottery per se does not correspond to culture, nor is suffice to define socioeconomic groups. So anyway, the archaeological research on the Western Balkan dimension of Cetina has gained new inputs in the last few years. The seminal work of Professor Govedaritza has sowed the seeds for the development of new patterns of research. He has rightly warned us against the construction of hypotheses about Cetina and movements toward the inland Western Balkans purely on typological affinities in pottery production, and stressed the importance of interdisciplinary studies and advancing archaeological practices with the adoption of models actually based on empirical data. Stasso Forenbaer's most recent works have provided a detailed overview on Cetina and address overseas mobility across the Adriatic via Palagruja and raw material procurement. In 2015, Elena Thomas has launched the CEVAS project, Systematic Archaeological Surveys in the Cetina River Valley, in order to reveal the settlement pattern of the Cetina culture and to examine spatial relationships between different clusters of tumuli and possible settlement. With the Enandris project, Maya and I are aiming at exploring the cultural, social, and economic dynamics underlying the Cetina phenomenon by adopting an interdisciplinary approach. In particular, we are carrying out 14th dates, archaeometrical analysis on pottery from Dalmatia and the other areas to explore provenance, but also technology and manufacturing traditions, and then stable isotope analysis on human remains to address phylodiet and subsistence economy, and the issues of short-range and long-range mobility. Maya, moreover, is carrying out a project focusing on the application of agent-based modeling to explain movements. So these last projects are closely interconnected and benefit from the collaboration of Stasio Forenbaer, other scholars, and local institutions. But the international collaboration and interdisciplinarity constitute the strongest point for advancing the knowledge on the Cetina culture and the archaeological perspective. Now, can we actually define a core area of the Cetina culture? Can we pinpoint defining cultural features and attempt to recognize borders? And what role did natural boundaries such as mountain and sea play in connecting or disconnecting? How can we explore patterns of interaction and mobility? So we don't have clear-cut answer now, but we take this conference as a welcome opportunity to critically discuss data and new research agenda. So if we try to figure out possible borders for the Cetina culture, it seems that high mountains may define these borders. So the Velebit Massif, the Velebit Massif define some marked border toward the north, while the Eiger mountain chain of the Dinaric Alps probably define the eastern border, while the South Massif of Montenegro Mountains may have constituted an element of topographic ecological discontinuity, but not a definite cultural boundary. To the south, a clear border seems to be marked by the Lake Skoder area south of Skader. This mountain scape does delimit the core area, but were in fact permeable boundaries. The Adriatic Sea to the west is traditionally a crossed area. Despite the paucity of data, what can be said about the Cetina groves in Dalmatia? The Dalmatinska Zagora offer river valleys interspersed by the karstic ridges, Mediterranean climatic condition, and Mediterranean taxa. We can assume that Cetina communities had a low demographic entity and a certain mobility of the territory, so that archaeological traces of settlement are very difficult to be detected. In the systematic surveys in the Cetina Valley have been demonstrating that small islets in the Cetina River were settled during the late prehistory and possibly also during the Cetina period. Yet, the lower river valley also is prone to sediment accumulation, which makes prehistoric sites very difficult to be found. Erosion, however, may be a key factor of the scanty preservation of settlement traces in the karstic plateau that characterize the lower slope of the valley. At present, no Cetina pottery has been found at Hillfort. On the other hand, coastal sites in Dalmatia are scanty, and marine transgression may have submerged them, but no evidence as yet came from underwater research. The tumuli, on the other hand, were mainly built on high plateau and ridge slopes, thus marking a different kind of environmental zone from the agriculturally suitable valleys. It is possible that tumuli have, of course, a social function as gathering place, but maybe they could have been also had the function of territorial marks. And so we can think about a short-range mobility across diverse ecozones that would be marked by the lower valley and possibly settlement in the lower valley and the tumuli on the ridge. So let's now examine the situation of the so-called peripheries. On the one hand, Cetina pottery has a wide distribution, both in the Western Balkans and in the neighboring regions, with a certain degree of stylistic and technological variability. Sacha Forenbauer has specifically worked on the stylistic variability of Cetina pottery across the various areas, defining degrees of closeness to the inspiring models. Yet, apart from Dalmatia, the distribution of Cetina pottery does not perfectly overlap with that of funerary tumuli, or at least the two are not always associated. In Istria, Cetina type pottery is scarcely known as yet. It has been found at Hillfort settlements such as Moncodonia and caves, and at least one burial tumulus at Barbariga has yielded Cetina type shards. In the Trieste and Slovenian karst, Cetina potteries chiefly come from caves, apart from a couple of settlements, but tumuli in these areas appear to come into use later on. In the area to the east, Bosnia and Herzegovina, and to the south, Montenegro and North Albania, burial mounds are widespread, and this funerary practice has a longer and well-rooted tradition. Cetina pottery is often found in tumuli beside its caves. Sometimes oldest tumuli were reused in this period, such as Velika Gruda and possibly Stoi tumor 6. Yet, Setina type shear frequently occur at sites that will become effort in the settlements in the Middle Bronze Age, such as Varvara in Western Herzegovina or Gaetan in Northern Albania. In Eastern Italy, although most of the Setina type pottery has been found as stray finds, none of them come from tumuli. The only funerary finds are from hypogea or rock cut tombs, which are traditional types of funerary sites in late Copper Age, early Bronze Age Italy. So, some differences are detectable across the core area and the peripheries. For instance, in the core area, a specific cultural traits appear to be the use of tumuli. Yet, outside Dalmatia, this seems to vary, possibly in relation to local traditional funerary customs. As regards the settlement pattern, a point to be understood is whether the appearance of Setina pottery in the to-be Ilford only outside Dalmatia depends on a research bias or whether this actually reflects different settlement choices related to local socio-economic patterns. So, it is highly possible that the spread of Setina-type pottery in the adjacent peripheral areas is to be related in most cases to the movement of a small group of people rather than to the exchange of goods. The factors that drove those groups to move remain to be understood, but this can be read in the framework of wider phenomena of mobility in the third millennium BC Europe. In any case, reason to move toward each region may have differed. For instance, presence in the Gargano area may be linked to a well-established tradition of raw material procurement. So which areas they choose to settle in? It would seem that in Adriatic Italy, they choose environments similar to that they came from. Instead to settle in the coastal line, they ventured into the inland ridge. In Istria, they found a similar karstic environment, and possibly they sought the same in the Trieste and Slovenian areas. On the other hand, in the Peloponnese, this group appeared to have embraced the locally well-established coastal settlement pattern. Setina-type pottery, in fact, has been found particularly at coastal or subcoastal settlement. Maran has proposed that the interconnection between Dalmatia and the Peloponnese were mostly seaborne in nature and that the main purpose was exchange. Evidence of exchange, however, are scanty. Moreover, new evidence from central Albania suggests that movements also crossed the southern Balkans. Epirus may represent a key region to detect possible inland routes. So, the group that moved would have maintained their identity, archaeologically reflected in the use of their traditional Setina pottery. At the same time, they probably adapted and integrated in the foreign communities. The socio-cultural scenarios they encountered in the various areas highly differ. For instance, communities of the early Eladic II and III Peloponnese had already taken a path towards social complexity that in other areas has yet to be established. So to conclude, mountain landscape has indeed a certain role for the Setina group, especially the low mountain landscape, and in the formation of economic and identity. But this phenomenon, this Setina phenomenon, deserves a more contextual approach and general explanation failed to grasp cultural variability and the complexity of cross-cultural encounters. Thank you very much.